today we start a new sermon series called the One Another Sermon Series. And if you ever get a chance, you can look up in the scriptures. There's over 25 different passages in the Bible where it says to do things to one another. For instance, it says to admonish one another, comfort one another, confess your sins to one another, forgive one another, pray for one another, serve one another, submit to one another, teach one another, fellowship with one another. Receive, it just goes on and on and on. There's so many different passages. So over the next several weeks, we'll be talking about the one another scriptures. And today we're going to focus on the one called love one another. And the reason I'm choosing that as the intro is because I really do think that's the foundation for all the one another scriptures. I think it's the most important one. We'll be looking at a passage where Jesus talked to his disciples and said to them, you need to love one another as I have loved you. And then he said, by this all men will know you're my disciples. And so we'll be talking about just the concept of love, because just using the word, sometimes it's so mystical. You know, everybody's got their different view and definition of what love is. Songs have been written, books have been written, wars have been fought, you know, poems are written, movies are made, all trying to give us some understanding of what this word love means. And hopefully we'll get a better understanding today as we look through the scriptures and see what the Bible says about biblical one another love. So we'll be starting in the Gospel of John this morning, but before we do, let's take a minute and let's honor the Word of God. If you have your Bibles, let's hold them up. Let's all say this together. Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Psalm 119:11. You know, each week we take a minute just to honor the Word of God, to encourage you to realize the power in this book. Over the years, I've had people say to me, well, I just don't understand what I'm reading. Well, I don't know if it's true you don't understand anything of what you're reading. I'm sure you're getting some of it, but don't be intimidated by what you don't understand. I believe this book is so powerful. If you'll just read it with an open heart, these words have a way of lodging themselves in your inner man, and they end up guiding you through life. This is the power of this book. But the point is, you do have to get it in there. So that's why every Sunday I encourage you, bring your Bibles, let's read it together, let's study it, let's get it in our hearts, and it will guide you through life. It'll help you make good decisions. So let's take a look at what God's, before we do, I got a text poll, here we go. Yeah, because we're talking about love, and a very special holiday is coming up this week. Somebody help me out that deals with love. What's happening this week? Valentine's Day. Yeah, so here's a little text poll for you. That was all the guys that said that, right? Yeah, you guys are right on it. How many Valentine's Day cards will be given this year? 1 million, 1 billion, or 100 million? So every time we have holidays, people always ask me, you know, what's the deal on this holiday? Is this a pagan holiday? And, you know, all of these holidays, Christmas, Easter, Halloween, Valentine's Day, they all have this combination pagan and Christian heritage. And as a result, some people say, I don't do that holiday, and they stay away from it. And I totally understand that. But over the years, I've just decided that I'll celebrate the holidays. I just try to celebrate the Christian heritage of the holidays. So Valentine's Day does have a good Christian heritage. Supposedly, it's following a pastor. His name was Valentine during the days of the Roman Empire. The emperor forbade marriages because he needed soldiers, and he thought if the guys were getting married, they wouldn't be going off to war. So he said, no one can get married unless the emperor says so. Pastor Valentine decided it'd be better they got married than have relations and live together. So he was marrying them, got caught marrying them, thrown in the prison, and was killed on February 14th. And so supposedly, as rumor has it, the day became a day for people to exchange love and to show love toward one another. So the whole idea of greeting cards, though, is something that, again, people get all upset about. You know, greeting cards have been distributed since the Middle Ages. So I know I see on Google people say Hallmark invented the holiday. No, Hallmark didn't. It was started way back when. Cards were distributed way back in the Middle Ages. Although Hallmark in 1913 started their card distribution, and they will make $14 million this week. Not a bad business to be in. You know, no wonder why they like the holiday. There's actually 1,400 different Valentine's Day cards that they produce. So man, if you can't find a card, that's a problem. 1,400 Valentine's Day cards produced by Hallmark for you to get something to say to someone you love it through a card. So what is the answer here? So according to Greeting Card Association, they estimate this year 1 billion Valentine's Day cards will be sent out. B as in billion, billion. 150 million in the U.S. will be mailed and handed out, and it's celebrated pretty much throughout the world. So, you know, get in on it. Don't be stubborn. Give somebody you love a greeting card, all right? But let's see what God's Word says about love, especially one another love. So let's turn to John chapter 13 this morning. John 13. And we'll read just two verses here. John 13. Toward the end of the chapter, verse 34, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. Then he says in verse 35, by this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. It is amazing to me how many Christians miss this passage. This is the key and the foundational principle of all evangelism and of advancing the kingdom of God. Many people think the kingdom of God is primarily advanced through outreaches, programs, witnessing, passing out tracts, inviting people, talking to people about God. All of those will fall on deaf ears if this is not present. This is the foundation. Jesus said, by this, all men will know that you are my disciples. Loving one another is the foundation for advancing the kingdom of God. Everything else plays into that, but that's the foundation, loving one another. As a young Christian, one of the pastors that had a great influence in my life was Pastor Chuck Smith. He's since passed, but he was the pastor of the Calvary Chapel in Costa Mesa, and I would listen to him and get to visit his church. But the things that he spoke, one of the things he always would say is this: healthy sheep reproduce healthy sheep. And that just stuck with me because what he was saying is if God's people will learn to take care of one another, if God's people will love one another, the church will grow. If we get that right, everything else will work. If we don't get that right, nothing else will work. And so many times people miss this and they think it's just about, you know, telling people about God. But really what's most important is learning this love one another principle. Part of the problem in the American church today is many, many people who call themselves Christians do not understand one another love. Gallup, who does surveys and polls, primarily does them in the United States, but he does them throughout the year on different things. He's done some surveys on Christians, people who call themselves Christian in the United States. He's come up with about 80 million people in the U.S. who say they're Christians. And then he surveyed them and said, you know, answer these questions based on how you manage your finances, how you raise your children, how you relate to your spouse, how you do at work, and all these different things. And what he's come to find out is that most Christians in America today live a lifestyle that is no different than those who don't call themselves Christian. That there's really no distinguishing factor. And I believe this is what Jesus is saying here. What's really necessary is there is a distinguishing character trait of God's people. And that distinguishing character trait, Jesus said, ought to be loving one another. You know, in the church today, there's lots of, instead of loving one another, there's lots of learning how to love yourself. And I'm all for understanding and getting a better self-image. Some people have been so beat up. You know, you need to be taught that you're worth something and you're valuable. You need to be taught that God has plans for you and he has a purpose for you. And you need to be taught that God wants you to prosper and be healthy. You know, but that cannot supersede this understanding of loving one another. That's got to be evident in the church. And I think part of the problem that it's not evident is because there's all this misunderstanding about love. You say the word love and everybody's got, you know, they just run in different directions, especially, you know, unchurched and what we would call non-Christian people. You say the word love, probably one of the first things that comes up is this concept of romantic love. You know, that's what love is. It's romantic love, and it means having sex. But you know, and the fact is lots of people engage in sex and there's no real love going on there, at least not biblical love. This isn't what Jesus is talking about. Matter of fact, a lot of that's just selfish love, just caring for yourself. Other people, especially parents, sometimes think the way to love your child is to indulge them. You know, give them stuff and make them happy and don't deprive them because you were deprived. You don't want them deprived. And you know, what happens is that just wrecks the kid's life. That's not love. That's really giving them a false concept. And then the big one today is this whole idea that love is tolerance. You know, if I accept your lifestyle, that means I love you, and that is not what love means. Just you don't tolerate someone. When you if you love them, you're not saying I accept and approve of your lifestyle. But that's what we're told today. That's what love must mean. I have to accept your lifestyle. If I don't accept your lifestyle, then I hate you. So I don't want to hate anybody, so I love everybody, and that means I accept your lifestyle. So there's like all this kind of confusion about love and hate. And then another major problem is that whenever we talk about love, our love is limited. I don't care how good you are, how kind you are, how friendly you are, everybody has a limit to their love. And all you have to do is turn on the news, and pretty much every day or so, you hear some story about someone whose love ran out. You know, you read a story about, you know, somebody is tired of taking care of their aged mom and dad 24 hours a day, and their love ran out and something bad happened. You know, you read about a single mom who's just, you know, weary of dealing with these kids and being the mom and dad all the time and struggling with finances, and her love runs out and something bad happens. You know, people run out of love when it comes to being nice to someone. Don't you think it's interesting that anytime a video hits YouTube about somebody being incredibly rude to their customers, it goes viral? I mean, you know, and then you read comments like, "Ah, they served them right. Those people are so bad." And it's like, you know, people just run out of love, man. It's like there's got to be a different concept. I was reading something the other day, and someone was talking about how they went and shoveled their parking spot in front of their house. And after they left for work, when they came back, the neighbor had parked in their parking spot. And that's where you find out how much love you have. You should have read the comments. I mean, they were outrageous. And you know, I could feel it rising up within me. Somebody said, "Go out there and shovel the snow back right where you took it and bury the car." One guy said, "Spray it with a hose of water, freeze the doors shut," you know. Just unbelievable stuff. And I'm thinking, oh yeah, okay, well that just means we have limits, okay? We have limits to our love. You can love all you want, but at some point, you're going to run out. And I don't believe that's the kind of love Jesus is talking about here when he said, "Love one another as I have loved you." And I think, first of all, we have to realize that this kind of love is not an option. In other words, you cannot be truly a part of the body of Christ and a part of the work of God if you've not gotten an understanding of this love. It's spoken of all the way through the Bible. Every letter written, James talks about it, John talks about it, Peter talks about it, Paul talks about it. Every letter, sometimes two and three times in every letter, they tell you, need to love one another. Here's just a couple of them. Being knit together in love, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. That's in Colossians. Paul wrote that. Here's one by Peter. Love one another fervently with a pure heart. Here's another one by Paul. Be devoted to one another in love. And then here's one. May the Lord make you increase and abound in love toward one another. This is in Thessalonians. Here's one in Galatians, Paul wrote. Through love, serve one another. One in Hebrews. Let brotherly love continue. There's one in John. For this is the message that you have heard from the very beginning, that we should love one another. It's in every epistle. Sometimes almost every chapter of every letter. It's the prominent theme, love one another. So, what is he talking about? So, one of the problems is, I say, love one another, and in the English language, we're still struggling. What does this mean? And part of our problem is we only have one word for love. And it's used so many different ways. So like you're walking through the park and there's a couple and they're holding hands and the guy says to the girl, I love you. And all the girls say, it's nice. That's nice. But a little later, the same couple is at the Mexican restaurant and the guy's eating a burrito and he says to the girl, I love this burrito. And all the guys say, that's nice. Same word, same word. I love you, nice. I love this burrito. All right, we use that. They get in their car, and on the car bumper, it says, I love the Browns. Now, now you want to cry for that. You know, that hurts. You know, I love the Browns. I love you. I love this burrito. I mean, it's one word, just one word. It's used so many different ways. I love watching, what's your favorite? I love watching The Voice. I love watching American Idol. I love my motorcycle. I love fishing. I love pizza. I love my children. I love my wife. I love all of you. Wow. A little bit of a problem here. You know, it's not, even though we have one word, it's not what Jesus was referring to. And so this is where you want to try and get a look at this. He gives us some insight. Look, love one another. Well, Jesus, what do you mean by that love? Well, here it is. As I have loved you. He's talking about a different kind of love. And really, the Greek word here, in the Greek language, there's many different words for love. And so if you did read Greek, you would pick up on this. This one is agape. And agape love is crazy kind of love. Agape love is not natural. Agape love is supernatural. Jesus is saying there's a different kind of love that's at work and should be at work among the family of God, and that is agape love. It's sacrificial love. It's selfless love. It's giving of yourself to others kind of love. It's not all about us. It's about someone else. That's the kind of love. Love one another the way I have loved you. Jesus gave himself to those around him. He served them. I mean, the ultimate serving, obviously, is when he hung on the cross. But his 3.5 years in ministry, he said, look at my behavior. This is the kind of love I'm talking to you about. Love one another. In other words, this is not romantic love that he's talking about. This is an act of the will. This is something you decide, you choose to do. You say, I will. In other words, this is not based on feelings. This is based on your decision. Now, there will be feelings that will follow, but it means we are responsible to do this. Love one another. He's telling us, this is my command. Love one another. So it must be possible, or he wouldn't tell us to do this. But I do believe that he's telling us that there's some help. You know, all the way through the scriptures, it's not just us doing it on our own. It's as we have received the love of Christ, we're able to love others. I believe that's really a key to this passage here. Love one another as I have loved you. As they walked with Christ those 3.5 years, they experienced the love of God in their lives. And I'm convinced until you have had an encounter with God, not an intellectual assent, I believe in God, I know there's a God in heaven, but until you've experienced the love of God as he has loved us, when you experience that love, it changes you. It truly touches you. It changes you inside. And as you continue to experience that, then you are able to love others. It's not something you conjure up. It's not something you earn and you say, I'm going to be good now. I'm going to start loving one another. It is part of a response. As I have received the love of Christ in my life, I can love others. I do have a responsibility, but it starts with my relationship with Christ. This kind of love is a personal decision. We have responsibilities. I was listening to a song the other day on the radio, and it's a new song coming out, and so they were interviewing the musician. And they asked the musician, where did this song, the words for this song come from? And it was a song about a breakup. She said, well, I just went through this really emotional breakup with my boyfriend, and she said, I wrote this song, and I learned, and this is what she said, I learned that love is not my responsibility. She said, love just happens. I'm not responsible. She said, it just happens. It's a chemical. It's a scent. And if it happens, it happens. And if it doesn't, it doesn't. I'm not responsible, she said. Well, some romantic love does have some of that it happens experience, but if we're going to talk about a deeper love, we are responsible. We do make a decision. It's a choice we make because we've experienced the love of God, and we get that press from the Holy Spirit to show it to others. And when we show it to others, Jesus said, "By this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another." So let's just look at one other passage of scriptures. There's many, but I just want to look at one where you kind of see Paul talking about how can you express this kind of love toward one another. If you go forward to the book of Philippians, turn to the book of Philippians, chapter 2. Again, there are many, many passages in the Gospel of John, 1 John, Galatians, 1 Corinthians, all these places give you more examples about how to express this love. I chose this one because I think this is a part maybe that some of us don't understand is a way to show love. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 1, it says, "Therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, any comfort of love, any fellowship of the Spirit, any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind." Verse 3 is the passage that I really want to point at. "Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others. Let this mind be in you, which also was in Christ Jesus." So he's saying, this is the kind of love Jesus showed. He humbled himself and came and put others ahead of himself. This kind of loving one another is another way of looking at it, is living it out loud, living it out with your actions. But not just in your actions. He says here, it's done the way you treat people. It's not just doing a kind deed. I did a kind deed. I love them. Well, that's nice. But how do you treat people? How do you treat people, especially those that you know? Now, if he's telling you here, you know, treat people with respect, and we think, well, yeah, there's people that I would treat with respect. In other words, if the governor was coming to my house, or a famous TV celebrity, or Billy Graham was coming to my house, man, I would greet the car when they pull up. I would be at the door. I would open the door. I would make sure they have a seat in the living room. I'd go check, make sure the food is being done, the food is really good. I would sit and listen to them. I would show them respect because that's a bona fide celebrity. It's like, yeah, I'm going to esteem them better than myself. That's a famous person. But I don't think that's all Jesus is talking about here when he says, esteem others, let each esteem others better than himself. How does that work when you have people that you know who are not famous? And your coworkers, and your siblings, and your spouse, and your friends, and your neighbors, they're not famous. What about esteeming them better than ourselves? This is the part I think Jesus is talking about, learning how to love one another, not just when it's easy and when it's convenient. It's challenging. It's very challenging, and it means sacrifice. It means giving up of yourself, and we are naturally self-centered, man. I mean, we're born self-centered. Everything is about us from birth, and the only way that I'm going to learn how to love one another is to continue to experience the love of God as he shows mercy towards me, as he shows kindness towards me and forgiveness towards me. It should flow out naturally. It is supernatural. But it should happen naturally. As you have experienced the love of Christ, let it flow out from you. There's tremendous power in the love one another concept. It's not easy. It's challenging. I believe it's supernatural. I truly do. I don't think we can naturally say, I'm going to love. I think our hope and prayer is that you will draw close to God and you will experience his love for you, and it will transform you, that you learn how to love one another. It starts in the house of God. It starts in the family of God. And it is the greatest witness of the kingdom of God. We live in a world that is starving for love. Even though it's everywhere in the movies and you hear it spoken of, it's not the kind of love that we crave in our heart. We crave for that all-accepting, forgiving, kind, sacrificial love that the Bible, agape love, and it only comes through the Holy Spirit of God, through God's people. Let's close in prayer. Father, I thank you that your love for us is so incredible. It never runs out. It's sacrificial. It's compassionate. It's respectful. I just thank you, God. It's a bit incomprehensible. It's not within us to even begin to understand that. But God, by your Holy Spirit, as we receive your love for us, help us let it flow out of us, God. Help us to show love to one another. That it would start in the family, in your house, and extend beyond. I know for each of us there are people in our lives that we struggle loving. But I just want to take a moment this morning and ask God if he'd just open our hearts up to be willing to love those that we may think don't deserve it. Give us that opportunity, God, to esteem others better than ourselves, to put them ahead of us. God, we pray that as loving one another abounds among your church here, God, that your kingdom would truly be advanced, that people would be drawn to something that is so supernatural. It changes our lives, God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's have our prayer team up front here as we get ready to close. We're going to Let's open your spirits up right now. Let's just listen to the Holy Spirit. Father, I know that you brought each of us here today for the opportunity to commune with you. And I just know, Father, that's your heart's desire toward us. It's not about going to church, singing songs, reading, but it's about communing with you. And Holy Spirit, we just open our hearts up to you right now. Just come, Holy Spirit, just come. And just as I was worshiping and praying this morning, I sense that there are some people today that maybe have even said this, but just feel like you're drained. And I just get this picture that you've been thinking you're drained, you know, maybe because you're not getting enough sleep or something else. But I just get a sense in my spirit, it's more than that, it's a spiritual drain. There's some of you really, your cup needs to be filled this morning. The Holy Spirit wants to just fill you so that you're overflowing. You sense the love of God filling you and overflowing. Also sense that there's some people dealing with some challenges at work. Someone, I just get this picture, someone really thinking of quitting their job. And maybe you need to move on, but I just get this sense that the Holy Spirit's saying, don't leave on a bad note. Just don't leave on a bad note. And some of these things apply to you. If you have some needs this morning, we're going to end our service a little differently this morning. We're just going to have a time for just some worship and ministry time. I'm going to close with one more song. And, you know, as we're worshiping, if you feel like you'd like some prayer, you want to have some time with God, we're going to have our prayer team up front here. We'll be happy to pray with you. And let's just give God that opportunity. If you feel that stirring in your heart, sometimes we just sense if we dismiss you, you know, you just get caught up in the activity and just brush it off. But if you're feeling that hunger or stirring or one of these words applies to you, we'd love to pray for you now while we have our last song.